listeners. Welcome to the next episode in Troutman Pepper's Patents Post-Grant Podcast. My name is Maia Harris, and I'm joined today by three of my colleagues, all out of Rochester, all in health sciences IP, Mike Goldman, Andy Zappia, and Ted Merkel. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me today. For those listeners paying super close attention to our last episode, you may have noticed that today's topic is different from the one that was promised at the end of our last episode. That's because the PTO earlier this month announced an extension to their motion to amend pilot program. And in light of that, we thought that it made sense to divert our attention just for a little bit and move to motions to amend an IPR. And I know that the panel has some fairly strong opinions on strategy on that point, and we'll get to all of that in a little bit. But maybe let's just start out with some basics. Andy, can you give us some context here for what the pilot program is and what the PTO's announcement might mean for those in the IPR practice world?
Sure. And what makes this topic timely and the reason we switch up the order a little bit is the PTAB just announced that they're extending the pilot program to September 16, 2022. So that's one of the reasons we wanted to move up this discussion. And with regard to, you know, what is this pilot program, the American Invents Act did lots of things, but it created some new procedures to challenge patents, including inter-parties review and post-grant review, and also a covered business method review. And as part of those procedures, the AIA allowed for motions to amend, meaning a patent owner could try to amend claims challenged in those procedures. The motion to amend process has been the subject of a lot of discussion because motions to amend have not been very successful at the board. And that lack of success is what led to the pilot program and now the extension of the pilot program. So just in general, a motion to amend can be brought as of right by a patent owner. The patent owner is required to discuss the motion with the board before bringing it, but can be brought as of right. It can be brought as either a contingent or non-contingent motion to amend. A contingent motion to amend proposes substitute claims, and that's only considered if the original challenge claims are found unpatentable. And then you can do a non-contingent motion to amend that cancels the challenge claims. Most people do the contingent. That seems to be the favored approach with substitute claims. And in the motion to amend, the petitioner has the burden of persuasion, and the Federal Circuit has been clear on that. Now, what led to the pilot program is the success rate has been really low on motions to amend pre-pilot program, and Ted can talk about those rates, but they were really low. So in 2016, the PTAB started a study on the motion to amend process and asked for comments in 2018. Then they came out with the pilot program on March 15, which became effective March 15, 2019. And there's two new features in the pilot program. First, with the motion to amend, if you choose to file one, you can request preliminary guidance from the board. That means the board will sort of tell you what they think about your motion to amend. And after you get the petitioner's opposition to the motion to amend, you can put in a revised motion to amend. You can adjust the claims to address the points raised. And for example, the preliminary guidance and the petitioner's opposition. And in that preliminary guidance that the board provides, it's non-binding. And the board can change its mind in its final decision. But it addresses all of the main elements required for a motion to amend. It has to address whether there's a reasonable number of substitute claims. And the presumption is your number of substitute claims should match the original number of the challenge claims. It's not a hard and fast rule, but that's the presumption. It will address whether your motion to amend addresses the invalidity arguments raised by a petitioner, because that's one of the requirements. It'll address whether the claims are narrow, the amended proposed amended claims narrow or broaden, because you're not allowed to broaden. So the preliminary guidance will address that. You're not allowed to add new subject matter in a motion to amend. So the preliminary guidance will address that, whether there's new subject matter added. And of course, the preliminary guidance will address the general standards for patentability, 101, 102, 103, 112. So those are the sort of things the preliminary guidance will tell you in a non-binding way. As part of that, as I mentioned, the second feature of the pilot program is the opportunity to put in a further revised motion to amend in response to the opposition and the preliminary guidance. So just so people know how the flow goes, you put in a motion to amend and say you request preliminary guidance, and most people during the pilot program, most motions to amend have requested preliminary guidance. The petitioner can put in the opposition. The board will give preliminary guidance. The patent owner can then put in a revised motion to amend. The petitioner gets to oppose that revised motion to amend. Patent owner gets a reply. Petitioner gets a surreply. Then it goes to oral hearing and final written decision. So that's how the process works under the pilot program in instances where a patent owner requests preliminary guidance.
So the additional element here, as I understand it then, is the request for additional guidance, which didn't exist pre-pilot program. It's kind of an additional step.
And the ability to file a revised motion to amend, because pre-pilot program, you put in your motion to amend, petitioner could oppose it, but you didn't get a chance to revise it. So that's the other second new element.
But you don't have to go through that process if you don't want to.
Correct. And also, so you don't have to go through the pilot program if you don't want to. It's optional. Most petitions post-pilot program use it. And even when you're in the pilot program, you don't have to put in a revised motion to amend. You could look at the opposition and the guidance and say, I'm pretty good with my claims the way I put them in originally. So you don't have to put in a revised motion to amend, but you have the option to do so under the pilot program.
Depending on which of those two paths you decide to take as a patent owner, that can result in the schedule before the board being shifted slightly in terms of the timeline. There will be, an additional month that gets tacked into the revised motion schedule before you end up having an oral hearing. Yep.
That's just the motion schedule. That's not the IPR schedule overall, though, right?
Correct.
I was about to kick it over to you, Ted, anyway, so you were prescient. Andy mentioned the success rates changing a little bit over time, or at least the pilot program being considered and implemented because of what was perceived to be low success rates. Have we seen any change in those rates of success after the pilot program has been implemented?
So the short answer there is yes. There has been an uptick in the overall success rate, and that is with respect to those motions to amend that are either granted entirely or only in part with respect to some of the amended claims. But taking a step back and looking at how many parties have changed their behavior, we're not really seeing any increase in the number of motions to amend, at least with the initial set of data that we've received from the PTAB. And that could be any one of a number of things. It could be that the patent owners aren't necessarily expecting to receive any benefit, so you're not seeing a large increase in the overall percentage of trials that end up filing a motion to amend. We may see an uptick, though, in the coming year, now that we've seen that patent owners actually are having a substantial increase in their success rate with the motions to amend. So to put some numbers on it, overall success using the old motion to amend approach before the pilot program, that was hovering around 14 or 15%. With the revised motion to amend under the pilot program, that's, and granted this is with a limited data set, but it's ticked up to close to 30% success rate, either wholly granted or partially granted.
So that's not insignificant, but your point's a good one, which is that we've got limited data to go by.
That's correct. The proof will be in the coming years. We see updated statistics with more motions to amend.
And I think if we could just jump to the $1 million question, because I think this to me is kind of the real point of interest. What are your thoughts on motions to amend overall? I mean, if we're not really seeing, a kind of an increase in patent owners making these motions generally, I'm wondering if there's a reason behind that. Any thoughts on that, Mike, Ted?
Well, I guess I'll start. I think the PTAB has struggled with the concept of motions to amend from the outset, even though the statute says that motions to amend are to be part of the process. They really have struggled with that because they fashion themselves as a court, a tribunal, and not an examination function. And I think they've had trouble with assuming an examination function, and that has made it very difficult for them to accept the role of doing just that. And I think that's been a problem, and I think that continues. So even with this pilot program, it still isn't a huge swing in a different direction that all of a sudden they're going to be doing what examiners do. It seems a little better, but it doesn't seem like it's going wholesale in a different direction. So to me, until the board changes its approach to how it deals with motions to amend or the patent office does to in some way be have an examining function as part of these post-grant reviews or IPRs, things really aren't going to change significantly. And it seems to me that there are better procedures to use if they are available to you, like if you can do a continuation or divisional, doing that. And if that's not available, if a reissue is available, I think those are all far better choices if you have them, rather than to try to resolve getting amendments in through the PTAB.
The stats are certainly against you, even if we're seeing an uptick. Ted, do you have any different thoughts?
The stats are definitely against you. You know, even if the success rate ticks up a little bit, you're looking at, at best, success one-third of the time. And that's a pretty low rate. You've got a lot more flexibility using the reissue that Mike suggested. For one thing, you're not bound by the number of claims that you can put in. So you've got a lot of alternative arguments you can make in the reissue process, and you just don't have that flexibility available in front of the PTAB.
Yeah, and this is Andy. One other point I'd make is that when you do the motion to amend at the board, you have the petitioner there actively fighting you every step of the way. If you do a reissue, there is the ability to put in an opposition, but it's a one-time submission. And in a continuation, if you go that route, I guess there's available a pre-issuance submission. But again, it's very different from the dynamic at the board, where in the motion to amend context, first you're making the arguments to judges as opposed to examination unit. And you've got the petitioner who can actively take shots at your submissions. And for example, with a motion to amend, you can put in a declaration. Well, then the petitioner can depose your expert and then try to pick apart the basis for your amendment. So I think that's another dynamic of the motion to amend that makes it maybe less favorable to a patent owner, and why you haven't seen a huge uptick in these motions, even under the pilot program.
I mean, you do have the estoppel advantage, though, don't you? If you go through, I mean, Andy, your point is a good one. You've got multiple additional obstacles to overcome in the IPR process, but aren't the rewards great if you succeed?
Yeah, but there's some risk if you fail, because if you try to do a motion to amend a certain, I'd be interested in Mike and Ted's view on this, but if you try to do a motion to amend for a certain claim limitation and it's denied, if you then try to make a similar amendment in a reissue or continuation, you could have an estoppel issue arise, a rule-based estoppel. So the estoppel, in my view, cuts both ways in the motion to amend context.
Now, I don't know if it's an official estoppel, but I do agree that patent examiners are going to be loath to counter what the board said about a motion to or an amendment. So if the board says that the amendment is raises issues of 112 or prior art issues, many examiners are going to be loath to challenge that and are going to be more likely to make a rejection and force the patent applicant to go and appeal to get that undone. So I think there is some word about that. I think to go back to Andy's comment about the opportunities for participation of a patent challenger in reissue or continuation, they're quite muted. They are not going to be very fulsome at all. You can, I think there's, like Andy says, a pre-issuance submission, and that's generally quite constrained as to what you can do, and it's certainly not something with an ongoing participation component. And there's also protests in reissues, which have a similar deficiency as far as active participation goes. So really, if I was a patent challenger and I knew the patent holder wanted to amend or was going to file new claims, I would be thrilled with the possibility that they chose to do that in an IPR rather than in an ex parte prosecution, where I'd have to go start another process to challenge a patent that issued that way in the future.
If you file, you know, I'm just thinking back to all that we've learned about reissue in a prior podcast, Mike. I mean, one of the pieces to a reissue application is that you think that there's some sort of defect that has to be cured. Are you essentially making an admission by seeking an amendment in a reissue that would be used against you in the IPR, or how do you avoid that?
Well, you have to identify one defect now in reissue. It used to be in days of yore that you had to identify all the defects, and there was a whole practice around doing that and all sorts of problems if you didn't. Now you have to identify one defect. So I guess I would be attempting to find a different defect than the one that would be problematic. And most people in the reissue practice are quite skillful at that.
This is Andy. I'll just mention that it's also possible for a patent owner to prepare a reissue but not file it until after final written decision. So that is a tactic that could be used.
All right. Well, it sounds like this panel is not in favor of motions to amend, which also sounds consistent with the statistics that we're seeing in the practice generally. I mean, just out of curiosity, and this is a total kind of question that requires some degree of just supposition on your end. I mean, if the process is so unpopular, what do you think the purpose behind this extension is?
I think they're trying to find something that mollifies the bar as far as for post-grant and IPRs. So this is the best they've come up with. They've tried and talked about all sorts of other things, such as having some sort of off-ramp to bring motions or amendments back to an examining function. They've talked about all sorts of things. I think the trouble with that is it weighs against the whole idea of meeting the time limit for being done within a year for an IPR or a PGR. So I think it would get difficult for the patent office to make a more fulsome and vibrant motion to amend practice work within the 1 year time frame. I think personally that's what they should do. I think if they do have an obligation under the statute to permit motions to amend, and my view is they've fallen short all this time. And I think not for lack of effort, but they've fallen short. And to me, the better move is to go and come up with a procedure that they integrate the examining function into it. If the board members don't seem to want to do that, bring it into the examining function, and if you have to run the trial for a longer period of time, so be it.
I was wondering if that time period was what might be driving this, because just listening to the process, it sounds to me like you're adding an awful lot of time and effort to an already relatively compressed schedule.
Yeah, they could push it. If they did an off-ramp to the examining core, they could push it pretty hard to get those things turned around on their end pretty quickly. I think they, you know, really, they should give serious consideration to trying that as opposed to these efforts to keep everything in the hands of the board.
Yeah, and this is Andy. I'm not a big fan of motions to amend. I like the other options, reissue, or if there's a continuation availability, I just think those tend to be better options.
I mean, reissue is always available because you're only going to, in the same context as a amendment, motion to amend in an IPR or PGR, because you can't broaden. So it's always available. Mm-hmm. And I think the only thing I could come up with is if you wanted to, you know, shoot for the moon and have it all resolved in one proceeding. I mean, I think that's the best thing, is if you wanted to, you know, get your claims through all at once and win.
Say if you had an underlying, I agree with Mike, this is Andy, if you had an underlying litigation that's been stayed and you really want to get the IPR process resolved, get the stay lifted, you don't want to have another patent that could be subject to another patent issue through a continuation or reissue where another IPR and stay could be entered. Like Mike said, you could roll the dice and do a motion to amend to try to get everything in one proceeding and try to get claims that come out at the end. And then if it's an amendment, you'd have to add those amended claims into your litigation, but then you can argue to lift the stay. And you could say everything's been vetted by the board, there's no basis for a further stay, et cetera. So that could be one reason to do it if there's an exigency with a co-pending litigation that's been stayed.
Yeah, I mean, I can see the other side now. Now that I've pressed you into coming up with a good reason, I can see the other side of that argument. And we've talked about this before, which is, you know, if your amendments go too far from your originally challenged claims, you also run into intervening rights and other issues that might be problematic from a recovery standpoint too. So I tend to agree, just sitting here listening to all of you, leaving aside the patent process and thinking about things from the context of parallel litigation, I can see an awful lot of reasons for not wanting to do this, but wanting instead to diversify your options using other processes. So thank you, gentlemen, and thank you to our listeners. We invite you to join us for our next installment of this podcast series, discussing strategy, trends, and other happenings at the PTAB. I am not going to predict what our next episode is because I've been proven wrong at least once before. So just join us next month. Troutman Pepper's intellectual property team helps clients develop and implement global protection and commercialization strategies for intellectual property assets in virtually all industry areas. For more info about how we can help you, visit the intellectual property section of Troutman.com. You can also subscribe and listen to our other Troutman Pepper podcasts wherever you listen to podcasts, including Apple, Google, and Spotify. Ted, Mike, and Andy, I will talk to you next month.
Thanks, Maia.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Copyright Troutman Pepper Hamilton Sanders, LLP. These recorded materials are designed for educational purposes only. This podcast is not legal advice and does not create an attorney-client relationship. The views and opinions expressed in this podcast are solely those of the individual participants. Troutman Pepper does not make any representations or warranties, express or implied, regarding the contents of this podcast. Information on previous case results does not guarantee a similar future result. Users of this podcast may save and use the podcast only for personal or other non-commercial educational purposes. No other use, including without limitation, reproduction, retransmission, or editing of this podcast may be made without the prior written permission of Troutman Pepper. If you have any questions, please contact us at troutman.com.